It's also, they have all the same people. They call such a structure a clinoform. Eh? That is the form of a inclined sheet. Here you have other clinoforms from another line. Here more clinoforms. And in fact, if you follow those clinoforms, you see that actually the next clinoform is gradually prograding more into the sea, into the North Sea, than the previous one. So each one offlaps, as we say, each clinoform is going further west and so forth. And they have distinguished 28 different clinoforms on top of each other. That's what Irina Overeem has been done. She is at present at the Colorado State University at Boulder and in America, still working a lot on modeling of fluvial systems. But she did a wonderful job here in the North Sea Basin. So this is what you see here, the clinoforms. And what do you mean, those clinoforms? Well, from your textbooks, you know how deltas are being formed. This is a typical textbooks example in which you see the river comes here from the left, and the coarsest sediment, they are rapidly deposited because of their coarse grain size, not far from the mouth of the delta. The somewhat kleiner silty deposits, they are deposited a little bit further in the sea because they are floating for a longer time in the water before they can settle. They have a longer time need to be settled, and so they can be transported further into the sea. And the finest clay particles, they go furthest in the sea, and they are formed here at the bottom. So this is what we call the topset beds. That is the slope beds, the foreset beds also, and these are the bottom set beds. And you see that as long when the delta grows, because sediment is continuously being put into the sea, and you see gradually that this delta is growing seawards. So this is the land, this is the sea. So these are the timelines. Once the delta was here, and you see coarse, medium, fine sediments, then sometime later it was here, coarse, medium, fine. And in this way, you see horizontal layers being formed by the progradation, as we call it, of a delta. This is a very common system which works in many deltas. The Volga Delta is a bit different because it has a very flat topography in the front of it. But most deltas, like the Mississippi Delta, which is the classical example, they have this built up with what we also call coarsening upwards, because here you get fine sediments at the bottom, a little bit coarser sediments on top of that, and here you get the coarser sediment on top. So that's the way in which you can also, in older deposits, you can recognize delta deposits because they are coarsening upwards, and that's what you see here. And you see at the same time here, this is the clinoform, the one that we saw in the seismic images. So that means here, this is the way in which finally those clinoforms have been formed. So the seismic images indicate that the clinoforms, that is an old delta, and that's the delta of the Eridanos River. That's what we are speaking about. Now, this is another seismic cross-section from unit 6 going to unit 23. This is a slightly sloping surface and erosional unconformity. And you see gradually offlapping more and more of those clinoforms forming into the basin of the North Sea. A huge system, a huge delta it is. It is 28 units, 1.5 kilometers thick, 2 million years old. That's a huge delta system which is being formed there. It is not the first delta which has been formed, because the nicest delta actually that the Eridanos River made before it came into the North Sea is exactly in the Kaliningrad area, around the place called Jantarny, which means amber place, Chłopowo in Poland. This is the first oldest Eridanos delta which is known, and it is known because this is the delta which made the deposits of the amber of the Jantarny. That's the Mrs. Kosmowska Czeranowicz was the one who gave the name Eridanos to this Bernstein Fluss, as it's called here, so it means amber river. So this is a delta, and it's of course heavily worked already for a very long time and so on. And we know that this amber also is deposited in this delta where we got, but that's not where it has been formed. You know, amber is risen from from trees, and probably sasna one with conifer trees, and it must have been forests that were present in the upper drainage basin of the Eridanos River, and that is the place, and so where the amber was coming from the trees. But the Eridanos River brought all those amber down to Yantarni, to Kaliningrad area, and of course that's where it's being mined now. So it is the amber which is found there is not primary. It has been transported by Eridanos River, and the primary sources are actually not really very well known, because nothing is left of the original forest that produced the amber. Now, if you don't know what's amber, you have to go to Carskoye Selo. There is the famous Catherine Palace with the Antarnia Komnata, the amber room. It's the second one. The first one was stolen by the Germans in the Second World War and disappeared at a certain moment. Maybe it has been burnt, because amber, of course, is can be burnt very easily. But this is the second I visited that with Sergei Zhilitinkevich, very famous Russian-Finnish scientist, who is a big friend of mine and also of Nikolai Sergeyevich. So we were there together, and they showed us this in Tsarskoye Selo, this wonderful sculptures of a room just clad with amber. Amber from Eridanos River, so it could actually be called also Eridanos River. That's where it comes from. So gradually after the amber interval, you see that Eridanos is growing. This is Phil Gibbert, is a very famous British geologist who has been studying the quaternary of the North Sea area during all his lifetime, a very active man. I met him once in a conference in Nebraska in the United States, but he was also in the Netherlands for some time. And you see gradually, this is the North Sea. You see Eridanos was first here in mid-Miocene. That's more or less the beginning of the 28 sections and so. And then you see an early Pliocene. You see it gradually prograde. You did progradation with the crinoforms, and still in the early Pleistocene, it is still further prograding into the North Sea. So that's gradually you see how this Eridanos River is being formed. This is an animation made by Irina Overeem of the different stages of the different clinoforms she has made, and you see gradually how the delta is developing. You see also how sedimentation is continuing from the east to the west, and you see also that the North Sea is becoming shallower as a result of this growth of the delta. It's really filling up the North Sea, what you see here. So this delta has not only been studied by looking at the seismics, but of course you want to know what's there. So there have been many borings. I showed already where they were in one of the previous slides. This is just a very small section of the drill cores they made from it. It's actually just an alternation of clay and silt and clay and silt. This is a very small section. Is it not much sand, but silt is a bit coarser. It's alivrit, that's a coarser material than the clays, who are really ill in most of the section. Actually, all those clinoforms you see are a result of the fact that every time clay and silt alternate in the respective clinoforms. So that's what you see here. So now, I won't go into much detail about it, but what you can see is in those drill cores is a huge amount of data which very precisely reflect what has been the history of those clinoforms, how old they are, whether sea level was low or high, whether the climate was warm or cold. They have been dated. Dating is being done by measuring the magnetic polarity. You know that the present North Pole is in the north, but 750,000 years ago, your compass would point to the South Pole. It's flipping all the time, and the polarity reversals are very well known, and in the time, so they have used this to date the sequence here, and you see it starts a little bit below 3.5 million years, and then goes up to a little bit less than a little bit more than 1.5 million years. So more or less 2 million years of sediment is present here. This is gamma ray, and gamma ray that measures the radioactivity of the sediments. And clays have a lot of potassium, and they are much more radioactive than sands or silts. So every time that you see a peak going to the right, it means it's much clay. If a peak to the left means it's much silt. And you see there's a gradual transition, clay, silt, clay, silt, clay, silt. Sorry. And that is that is very important, because it indicates the clinoforms, each of the clinoforms more or less represents a period of warmer and colder climate, and a period of higher and lower sea level. During high sea levels, you have mainly silt deposition. During low sea level, especially in the Pleistocene, in the upper part of the sections, then you get more clay deposition. And why are they studying this in so much detail? Because the coarser sediments they contain gas. One of the bounties of the North Sea is not only oil, which comes from much deeper, from the Cretaceous, Jurassic, but here in Tertiary, in the Neogene, and the Pleistocene, there's gas. So they want to know where is the gas and how much is it, and can they get it out? So that's those gamma ray is very important, used in oil, in all categories of oil exploration, because it gives you an idea if there is porous material like sands, which could hold oil or gas, then they have a low signature, low values, and if it's the oil is covered and protected from going out, then it is a clay deck, which is indicated by the high peaks in the gamma ray and so on. So on the land in the British, in Britain, and also in the Netherlands, they have names for the different periods in which it comes. The seawater temperature can be derived from dinoflagellates, that are small plant-like organisms which mainly living plankton in the sea. And from the species, you can see whether it was warm or cold water. This is benthic forms, which you see here. Foraminifera, this is other foraminifera, this is still Neogene plankton, all kinds of bioindicators indicating whether the sea level was saline or fresh, whether what kind of species were living there. Pollen events, pollen from plants, they give you an idea about the vegetation around the North Sea, and you also see that changing with climate change. So it is a very powerful series of data which indicate how actually this delta has been formed, how climate change has changed all the time the depositional conditions and ecological conditions in the North Sea and the surrounding areas. So this is just one of the many holes that has been studied in this wave, and therefore it's a very important section anyway. Well, as I said, on the land there are also deposits from Eridanos River. This is just a picture from Denmark, when you see also the cross-bedding. It's on the land, it's a bit coarser. It's not deep water there, of course, it's fluvial sediments. This is a very nice outcrop in Denmark. We have them in the Netherlands as well. In the Netherlands, the Eridanos River is characterized also by white sands, just like in Denmark. Only in Holland, we have the problem that Holland is the sink of many deltas, not only from the Eridanos in the early times, but also from the River Rhine, which comes here from Germany, and the River Meuse, which comes here from Belgium. And so there are many deposits in which there is a mixture of Rhine and Meuse and Eridanos sediments. And I have tried with one of my students, Leo Tebbins, to find out how we can distinguish the sediments of Eridanos from those of Rhine and Meuse. And we came to the solution that we picked out the garnets in the heavy mineral concentrates from the river deposits. The river deposit mainly consists of quartz and a little bit feldspar, and 1 or 2% are heavy minerals like garnet or hornblende of epidote, which are very common and give a very good idea about the conditions in the drainage basin. So we started to look at the sediments which we knew were from the Rhine, and we see those have garnets which have mainly deposits have mainly garnets with a high amount of iron and magnesium. Here you see it, iron magnesium at the top. There's an almandine, mainly had the iron-rich garnets. And that's very typical for the Rhine. Here you see another also from the lower Pleistocene and the upper tertiary. So you see very typical, those are every data point is a garnet composition which we measured with the electron microprobe. Now the Meuse is quite different, you can see it, because the Meuse has a lot of spessartine, the manganese garnets from the Ardennes. That is a low-grade metamorphic garnet types which are typically developed in the Ardennes area. And the White Sands, he said they have a much rather larger spread of garnet compositions, not so much manganese, but still quite a lot of different, also more towards the calcium, the gracilorite type of garnets. So this indicates that, of course, the drainage basin of Edinanus is much bigger, so those granites come from the whole of Scandinavia, and it's no surprise that you find a bigger spread of data. So that's how we can distinguish this, the different river types by the type of heavy minerals that are being deposited. At present, you would also take, this is already some time ago, you would take the zircons from the sediments and try to date them, and of course then you will find much older zircons from Eridanos than from Rhine and Meuse, because Eridanos drainage basin is in the Precambrian Baltic Shield, and Rhine and Meuse are in the Paleozoic and the Mesozoic origins of Central Europe mainly. But then a disaster occurs, and that disaster means glaciation, ice ages. Because further high up in the Pleistocene, we get several times that big glaciers, big ice caps are covering the Elsterian, the Salian. You have a Moscow glaciation here, and they have also all the different Russian names, which I don't remember exactly by head. But you see, this is the Elsterian, the pre-penultimate glaciation. This is the last but one glaciation. This is the one which went furthest and covered also the Netherlands and Denmark and so on. And we see that effect in the seismic images of the North Sea, because suddenly we saw deep holes in those clinoforms here. And this is in the Danish part. You see that they form huge channels, and these are no longer river channels, as you see, but these are channels, meltwater channels below the ice cap, which at that time covered Western Europe. Within the channels, you can also see some stratification, and this is also in the North Sea. So you see this, actually, there's something happened to Scandinavia. And you can imagine what happened to the Baltic, to Eridanos River. It was all covered with ice. That's something that suddenly interrupted the whole series of delta formation in the North Sea about 1.5 million years ago already. And there have been certainly 20 ice ages, but we do not know the effect of the earliest ones. But those are Elsterian, so the last but two ice age, which is very prominent to be found in the seismic sections of the North Sea. In the Netherlands, we call it push moraines. The moraines is coming. The ice cap is coming and pushing the previous sediments into tectonic slices, almost, you could see here. And they put also some sediment on top of it. This is the present push moraines in the Netherlands, very prominent features. Netherlands not totally flat, but because of the ice movement in the penultimate glaciation, you get that you get some hills here. And these are the White Sands of Eridanos, who have been affected by the pushing ice cap, because you can see this is a fault. This is a fault line. This line is suddenly stopping here and it's going further here. This line stops here and then goes further here. This is a reverse fault, the result of pushing of the ice age, of the ice cap in the penultimate glaciation. So you see that here, in fact, there is very clear that the deformation in the Eridanus is the result of deformation of the ice cap that rolled over the Netherlands and scoured deep valleys 100 meters deep. It left a lot of sediment as well. So this is in a very different type of sediment from the Eridanus than we know from the Delta. These are big chunks of of rocks, Scandinavian rocks, from Sweden and Finland mainly, and they have been used by prehistoric people, Neolithic people, 3,000 years before the Common Era, to build probably tombs, dolmens they call it, and there are many of them in the Netherlands and also in Germany. But all those rocks come from Scandinavia, and actually there are a lot of archaeologists and geologists who have been trying to find out exactly where a certain rock type comes from, and they have been able to reconstruct exactly the pathways of the flow of the ice by looking at where does those erratics, as they are called, the erratics, where they really come from, and so on. And there's a Dutch artist, a very nice man called Bart Eising Smeets, and this summer he brought one of those erratics back to where it had come from. This is a Rapakivi granite from Åland Island, or Ahvenanmaa, as they say in Finnish. And he brought it back. This is the mayor of Mariehamina. This is the rock which he brought back. He said he has nostalgia, this rock. It wants to go back where it came from. Very nice story. So it's not geology, it's art. And I like this kind of art. This stone has some kind of memory where he came from, and he really wanted to return to the place in those Ahvenanmaa, Åland Islands, between the archipelago, between Finland and Sweden. So, well, very nice. I love it. It's a very nice story. And another effect is that the moraines that came from the east also were deposited in the North Sea. So the amber that came from the Antarne was also deposited, also transported by the glaciers much further west. And here, this is an amber which was found in the island of Ameland in the Dutch Frisian Islands. And so it comes from the moraines that were deposited by the glaciers in the North Sea, and the waves transported it to the shore. So this is amber from the Antarne. Actually, the second place where it has been transported, because the first place was, of course, from Estonia to Kaliningrad, and this is the transportation by the moraines and now by the waves to Ameland. So we find amber in Holland, but it is amber which is, of course, Baltic amber, which has had a long history to get there. So. Well, during the last ice age, this is about 20,000 years ago, again, a nice ice cap was formed in the same area. And it's for the maybe third or fourth or fifth time, the Eridanos Valley was filled with ice. And actually, this is the glacial maximum, the largest extension of ice in the last glacial. We see that it came just across Denmark, but not to the Netherlands. In the Netherlands, we had periglacial permafrost, but not ice cap. All the ice cap is from the previous glaciation. Very important. This is, of course, the one that has been studied best. One of the possibilities is that the proglacial lakes that were here made all the rivers that are now flowing northwards, like the Northern Drina and Pechora and so on, southwards, and link up with the Caspian Sea, where we have been working a lot with Nikolai Sergeyevich. But this last glaciation is known very well. This is an older picture, but it is very nice because you see here not only the height of the ice, the contours, but you see also the flow lines. And what you see very nicely here is that the Eridanos River was a glacier of its own. This is the glacier tongue of the Eridanos Glacier. And that is the reason why the river disappeared. It was scoured deeply by the ice, and the ice didn't care at all that it was an older river basin. But of course, it followed the lowest parts of the topography, and therefore it is the ice tongue which scoured out the whole drainage basin of the Eridanos River, and therefore it is as wide as it is now. That's actually the reason. The ice made killed, you could say, the Eridanos River as a river. This is a very beautiful image which I got from the internet, in which you see what the bottom of the Baltic looks like at present as a result of the scouring of the ice. This is here is Kaliningrad, you see where we are. This is the Jantarni area here. This is here Sweden, here is Stockholm. Well, this is really wonderful. You can imagine that the river cannot follow all those deep, so there's no way that this can be returned in a river when at the end of the ice age. You cannot follow that. Well, after at the end of the last ice age, the ice was retreating, a lot of meltwater came in what is then the Baltic Sea. Of course, we had a freshwater lake here. And then when the gap became smaller and smaller, there came a corridor from the North Sea into the Baltic Sea, and you see that a new saltwater sea is being, saline sea is being formed. But then gradually the land lifts up and it becomes again a freshwater lake, and then the last stage, in which is more or less the present situation, sea level rise was so strong that it overcame the uplift of the Scandinavian area, and therefore it's now a sea again. So you see, this is also the history of the sea level. It's coming up, it's falling down, and it's coming up again. This is the four tiers history of the Baltic Sea. And the seismic data have also been obtained from the present bottom of the Baltic Sea. And there you see those different stages, the Enceladus Lake, the third stage, very typical sediments here. This is Litorina, that is the last stage more or less. Here is recent sedimentation going on. This is thickness about 10 meters, quite a different thing than the 1.5 kilometers we had in the Eridanos Delta. But actually, this is more lake deposits and marine deposits, and no longer river deposits. But active sedimentation is going on. So this is the start of the Holocene, the period in which we live now. And we see that it still is happening something. But if we look at present day sediments, one other point, we see that the deposits going from north to south are getting thicker in the whole Baltic Sea, going from northern Sweden and Finland to Denmark. You see, gradually it's getting thicker, and also these are the four stages that we just have seen so far. Now, but if you look at present bottom sediments, and you are interested in pollution of rivers, of course, and these are data from the Suomen ympäristökeskus, that is the Finnish environmental agency, and you see that quite a lot of heavy metals, cadmium, mercury, lead, nickel, chromium, arsenic, copper, zinc are above the limits that are allowed for the maximum limits. Mercury and chromium come from different rivers. It's mainly industry in the Gulf of Finland, where those high amounts of sediments, of polluting sediments come from. So we see that the present day situation is not so good because of all of the sediments that come into the sea, the contaminated sediments that come into the sea. Maybe that's not even the worst, but if we look at the bottom sediments, we see barrels, we see shipwrecks on the bottom of the Finnish Gulf. This is the Estonia ferry, which was sunk in along the west coast of Finland. So that is present day sediment, no longer clay silts or big erratics, but these are the modern type of bottom sediments you find, unfortunately. So it is very much polluted so far. We see also military chemical waste dump near the island, the Danish island of Bornholm. They say, well, it is rather safe there, but we cannot see it in the sediments, but there must be quite a lot of chemical warfare agents here, which have been dropped here to get rid of them. So that is in the Bornholm. So actually the bottom of the Baltic Sea is quite polluted, as so you could say. Well, and now they made a new Eridanos, not for water, but for gas. This is Nord Stream The Nord Stream pipeline, which goes through the Finnish Gulf between Estonia and Finland, across Sweden, they don't go to, that's too much, it's too quick, through Germany. Well, the one right through the chemical waste dump from Bornholm to Germany to bring Russian gas to Western Europe. And you know all the political discussions that go on to make a second pipeline, but it is the first pipeline is functioning. So this is Nord Stream, and actually I regard it as the resurrection of Eridanos. It flows again, but now with gas and no longer with water. So that's actually very interesting to see how in a very different way there is still matter flowing from St. Petersburg and its and the area to Germany. No longer fresh river water, but gas through a pipeline. Now, we look a little bit at the future. We almost finished, but we look at the future. Well, if we look at the Finnish coast and the Swedish coast, you see something strange is happening. 300 years of the common era, so after Christ, you could say, this was the coast, west coast of Finland in southwestern Finland. And you see the coast has been growing. It has been growing. This is the town of Vaasa. Every time more islands emerge and so. So what's this? We are all used to think about sea level rise and so. But here it seems to be the opposite. Here it seems that sea level is falling. How is that possible? Or is the land going up? That is something that you have to imagine. Now we know actually what's happening there. Because under Celsius, the man that gave us our temperature scale has been finding it out in the east coast of Sweden. And he found evidence that the coast is uplifting. This is the Löfgren stone on the Swedish coast. And you see, he made a mark here. 1731 was this was the sea level. 1878, this was the sea level. 1888, it was here. So you see, it's uplifting. And this is the sea level curve of Stockholm from 16,000 years ago to now. And you see actually that also this is not sea level rise, but sea level fall. And how does it come that Scandinavia has sea level fall and the rest of the world has sea level rise? Well, again, this has to do with the ice cap. This is just a picture of England, doesn't matter what you take. When there's an ice cap forming, the ice cap pushes the land surface down into the Earth's mantle, because it is plastic and so. And as a result of that, viscous material from the Earth's mantle flows from beyond from under the ice cap further to the south. So this area is being uplifted here in the ice age. And when the ice cap melts, then you get the opposite effect. All those viscous material in the Earth's mantle flows back, and therefore you get uplift here in this area where the ice cap has disappeared and sinking here. So land is sinking here. We in the Netherlands, unfortunately, are sinking here. That's one of the reasons why we have a lot of problems with sea level rise. But in Scotland and also in Scandinavia, they don't have this problem. This shows that the northern part of the Botnic Gulf is still rising at a rate of 8 or 9 centimeters a year. So that's why it's growing. It has been uplifted already more than 300 meters, the whole of Scandinavia. So that is actually why the land is uplifting. This is actually the contour of the old ice cap. So that's why it's uplifting. And if you look a little bit further, this is, if you look here in this area, southwestern coast of Finland, again, the town of Vaasa, which we saw on the previous slide. In 4,000 years, there will be a land bridge between Vaasa, between Finland and Sweden. And Eridanos River will lose part of its drainage basin because the uplift makes that a connection between Sweden and Finland here as a result of a continuing uplift. So you might ask what happens to Nord Stream. It's further south, but of course the sea is also getting shallower at the place where Nord Stream is starting. I'm not sure that they had thought of it. Of course, this is not the final problem that they have. The final problem comes in the next ice age, when there is a new ice cap, maybe 20,000, maybe 50,000 years from now, in which again St. Petersburg is covered by ice. Helsinki, Stockholm, Oslo, Copenhagen, Berlin are all disappeared. They all become incorporated in the push moraines in the western half of Denmark, or maybe even in the Netherlands, but also England, and so it goes. And you see, because sea level is dropping then, so the Azov Sea is getting dry, Venice is getting dry. So all those people have to find a new place to live. Of course, the North Sea is also dry, so we get some extra country in the Netherlands for the refugees in this area. So it takes a lot of time, but if you look at the longer history of Eridanos and in general of climate history, we are going already to the next ice age. The maximum temperature was 6,000 years ago. It goes very slowly before we come at the next ice age, and smaller climate change are being superimposed of it on it, like the little ice age and that kind of periods. But sooner or later, in couple of 10,000 years, the ice cap will return. It has actually already returned in Hardangervidda and one of the small glaciers in the southern part, the higher part of Norway. But they still have to extend quite a lot before they can get the same extent. So what will happen then? Then we will find the erratics of the Eridanos Delta in the area that was at the foot or at the of the next ice age. This is more or less how it will look like. This is Ozero-Bielie in northern Russia at present. But you see the barrels that were at the bottom of the Finnish Gulf. They will be deposited at the end. And what happened to Nord Stream? Well, probably something like that. Thank you very much for your attention.
Thank you a lot, Professor Cronenberg, for the excellent talk. And I would now proceed with the questions which we got from the participants. So we have some minutes for that. So I just would read the question that we got. So the question from the student of geochemistry of landscape department of Moscow State University. So when was the Eridanos discovered? Are there any connection between Eridanos deltas and Curonian split formation?
Which formation, sorry?
Curonian, right.
But Curonian, that is 4 billion years ago, huh? That's
Curonian. So
I don't understand.
Okay, then maybe when was the Eridanos discovered? So maybe that's the point can be.
Well, the deltas were actually discovered in this for the first time described by my PhD student and Catherine Bishop Kay in the UK. This was the first paper on the delta, but the older delta was already found in as I told in Yantarni area in Kaliningrad area, but it was such a huge delta is relatively recently known. There must have been a precursor. The actual shape of the Baltic with the Gulf of Finland is, according to some geologists, already related to old rifts in the Baltic Shield, which can be indeed Huronian or Precambrian at least. So why is there this Gulf of Finland? The primary could be a tectonic. Not that the scientists do not agree about it, but it can be very old. So the pathway of the river itself could have been formed by very old tectonics already several billion years ago. Yeah, is that the answer to the question?
So I think yes. I can't ask the participant if he is agreed, but I hope yes. That's quite clear. Yeah. Okay, then I go forward with the next question. It's the question from Mikhail Makarov. So does global warming affect the spread of the Eridanos River, and if yes, then by how much? So I guess it's a little bit...
Well, the river doesn't exist at this moment. Eh? So, and the present day global warming contributes a little bit, for instance, to the melting of the Greenland glacier. But what we see at present is that the land uplift of Scandinavia goes much quicker than the sea level rise as a result of the melting glaciers. And the sea level rise goes more or less at 20 in the Netherlands, for instance, 20 centimeters per century. That's the already since the 19th century. But the Scandinavia rises up eight centimeters per year. That is, it goes much, much quicker. So in Scandinavia and so also St. Petersburg and Kaliningrad, they will not be affected by sea level rise, but rather by sea level fall as a result of the uplift of the scale. In the North Sea, of course, it's different. We see as a result of the sinking around the old area of the ice cap, we see that more sediment is being deposited there. And so the North Sea is rising, but still not very quickly. We don't see, for instance, an increase as a result of an acceleration of sea level rise in the North Sea area as a result of the CO2 output. We don't see it. It's all, whenever you look along the whole North Sea, it is more or less 15 to 20 centimeters per century. So if sea level rise affects coasts elsewhere, it's not here. Yeah?
Okay, very detailed. Vision. I think we, as far as we are a bit short in time, so I would translate one more question. There are a few more, there is the question from PhD student of hydrology department, also of the Moscow State University, Vasily Efimov. So the question is whether it is possible to say that the sand massif of Dogger Bank was formed mainly by deposits of the Eridanus River.
I cannot see your mouth. It was about Dogger. Yes, please. Yeah. What's about Dogger Bank? What's the question?
Yes. So it is the question. It's possible to say that the sand massif of the Dogger Bank,
yeah,
was formed mainly by deposits of the Eridanus.
No, that's not right. It was formed as a result of the push moraines in the penultimate glaciation. It is a glacial remain and not an Eridanus remain. It is resting on Eridanus deposits, but the Dogger Bank itself is partly the result of glacial processes. It's a very interesting because when sea level was rising until about 7,000 years ago, the Dogger Bank was an island in the North Sea, and people lived there. So that must have been one of the greatest environmental disasters in the period when the people at that time saw their island becoming smaller, smaller, and smaller. They all must have drowned, say 7,000 years ago. So if they want to make a hub there for the windmill electricity, but what they will find is the bones of the people who drowned there 7,000 years ago.
So we would then finish with Professor Kronenberg talks. We are very proud to have your lecture here. I think it's in the big list of your presentations in Moscow State University. It's like
you.
A big collection of that of your talks. So thank you very much that you came. And I hope to meet you next summer on the Baikal Lake then.
I hope so too, yes. Thank you very much.
Okay, so we have now the few minutes break. Yeah. And at 12 we will continue, so.
Okay, thank you. Bye.
Bye-bye.